بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين سيدنا ونبينا ومولانا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. And welcome once again to the session presented or offered by the Sheikh Abadi Institute, Understanding Our Heritage for a Brighter Future. The Learn to Understand series, addressing some of our activities, traditional activities in Cape Town, and taking our relationship with recited phrases and recited texts from recitation to understanding. And one of these texts is what we in Cape Town refer to as the riwayats, which is drawn from an Arabic word riwaya or riwayatun, which means a narration. It is actually from a elegant and eloquent work by a scholar of Medina that lived just over 300 years ago. And his family name was Al-Barzanji, for his grandfather was originally from a place in northern Iraq called Barzanja. But this sheikh's father and he himself were both born and educated lived and taught in Medina. In fact, this sheikh, Al-Imam Al-Barzanji, taught in the Haram of Medina, in Al-Masjid al-Nabawi. So he compiled a beautiful text, a rhyming prose text regarding the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, introducing his lineage and speaking of his birth and his life in Mecca up until his arrival in Al-Madinatul Munawwara. The compilation consists of 22 individual sets of work, sets of information. And in Cape Town, we traditionally recite the first four sets. We've covered the first set, the first riwaya, which is used by the Sheikh Al-Barzanji to introduce his intention with the work. The second riwaya we covered as well, which addresses the beautiful, authenticated lineage, noble lineage and ancestry of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And this evening we will be looking at the third riwaya, the third set of content, where the Sheikh describes the scene before the prophetic birth. The scene up until the time where the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is to be born. So he says, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Allahumma salli wa sallim wa barik alayhi, and our traditional phrase of salutation, عطر اللهم قبره الكريم بعرف شذي من صلاته وتسليم. ولما أراد الله تعالى إبراز حقيقته المحمدية وإظهاره جسما وروحا بصورته ومعنى ولما أراد الله, you can add it, تعالى, and when Allah the Exalted wanted to إبراز, wanted to bring forth, wanted to show, wanted to produce حقيقته المحمدية, his Muhammadan reality, referring to the Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that was referred to in the previous text as a nur, a light that was passed on from generation to generation, from Nabi Ismail alayhi salam down through his descendants to Adnan, and from Adnan to Ma'ad, etc., down to Abdul Muttalib, to Abdullah. So the Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, as he himself informed that he was a prophet before or when Adam alayhi salam was between the body and the soul. We mentioned that two or three sessions ago. And referring to Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam as a nur, Allah does so in the Holy Quran, as we refer, as we mentioned before, قَدْ جَاءَكُمْ مِنَ اللَّهِ نُورٌ وَكِتَابٌ مُبِينٌ. That's chapter 5, I think it's verse 15. There has indeed come to you from Allah a light and a clear book. All the Mufassirun say the light is Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And it's no surprise Allah refers to Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as a lamp as well, سِرَاجًا مُنِيرًا, an illuminating lamp. So anyway, the author here, the scholar Imam al-Barzanji, takes us from having referred to Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam as a nur. Now he says, when the time came when Allah wanted to produce the reality, the human form of Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, ay ibraz haqiqatihi al-Muhammadiyya, to produce his, a Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam's Muhammadi, Muhammadan form, Muhammadan reality, from a nur to a human form. Wa idharahu jisman, and to show him, to bring him to appear, jisman, in body, wa ruhan, and soul, bi suratihi wa ma'na, in form, in his form, in his form and meaning, bi suratihi, in his form and complete meaning. In Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam's human form and in all that is to be expected and understood from the meaning of a messenger, from what it means to be a messenger. You understand? When Allah wanted this to happen, and Allah wanted to bring forth and produce the reality of Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and to show him, bring him out as a body and a soul in his complete, beautiful, handsome and complete form, and in his meaning as a prophet, in all that it means to be a prophet, what happened? نَقَلَهُ إِلَى مَقَرِّهِ. He transferred him to his abode. Allah transferred Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam to his abode where? Min sadafati aminat az-zuhriya, in the pearl oyster. In the pearl oyster of Amina az-zuhriya. What's the pearl? Sadafa. Pearl oyster is the womb. Is using a metaphor referring to the womb of a Sayyida Aisha, Sayyida Amina, as the oyster where the pearl is in. And the pearl is Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But the oyster, the pearl oyster of Amina. You get the idea? He's referring to the Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam as a pearl, and is referring to the womb of Amina as the oyster that the pearl comes in. And that pearl oyster is a sadafa. And az-zuhriya is her nisba, meaning her tribal name, because she was from Banu Zahra. Okay? So Banu Zuhra. And therefore anyone from Banu Zuhra is az-zuhri. And a woman from Banu Zuhra is az-zuhriya. Naqalahu ila maqarrihi min sadafati aminat az-zuhriya. Wa khassaha al-qareeb al-mujeeb بأن تكون أما لمصطفى وخصها القريب المجيب. القريب is the one who is near. Let's make it capitals because it's referring to Allah سبحانه وتعالى, the one who is near and responsive. المجيب is the one who is responsive, the one who responds to you, to the calls. Al-qareeb al-mujeeb khassaha, the one who is near and responsive, خصها means specified her, especially selected her. Allah, who is al-qarib, the one who is near, and Allah, who is al-mujib, the one who responds to everyone, the one who is responsive, specified her, specified Amina, to be what? Bi an takuna, that she be umman, a mother, li Mustafahu, for his chosen one. That Amina be a mother for the chosen one of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So let's read those two sections. وَلَمَّا أَرَادَ اللَّهُ وَلَمَّا أَرَادَ اللَّهُ إِبْرَازَ حَقِيقَتِهِ الْمُحَمَّدِيَّةِ. And if you add ta'ala after Allah's name, it's good. وَلَمَّا أَرَادَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى إِبْرَازَ حَقِيقَتِهِ الْمُحَمَّدِيَّةِ وَإِظْهَارَهُ جِسْمًا وَرُوحًا بِصُورَتِهِ وَمَعْنَاهِ نَقَلَهُ إِلَى مَقَرِّهِ مِنْ صَدَفَةِ آمِنَةَ الزُّهْرِيَّةِ وَخَصَّهَا الْقَرِيبُ الْمُجِيبُ بِأَنْ تَكُونَ أُمًّا لِمُصْطَفَى. أُمًّا, you can join Ummal li Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Okay. Now it becomes interesting. وَنُودِيَ فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ بِحَمْلِهَا لِأَنْوَارِهِ الذَّاتِيَّةِ وَصَبَى كُلُّ صَبٍ لِهُبُوبِ صَبَاهُ. Okay. For the next few sections until the end, I'm simply going to translate. Explain when there's need to explain, and in the end, I will present to you some ideas to consider. Because what he's going to say now, some would consider it a metaphor, as a poet would exaggerate at times, or speak with hyperbole, meaning exaggeration. In an attempt to express what he feels and what he imagines was happening at the time. You understand? However, even though certain sections that are to be presented now and translated now and explained now seems like an exaggeration, it has its origin in our texts, and I'm going to present to you some texts at the end of this presentation, inshallah, just to ponder about. So he says, وَنُودِيَ فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ, and it was proclaimed, it was called in the heavens, وَالْأَرْضِ, and in the earth, بِحَمْلِهَا, that she was carrying, an announcement was made regarding the fact that Amina was pregnant with what? لِأَنْوَارِهِ الذَّاتِيَّةِ, with his personified light. We mentioned that Nabi Muhammad SAW was referred to as a light. And this light, this nur, based on the author's text, this nur was passed on between his forefathers up until it reached his own father. And that nur was then the start of Nabi Muhammad SAW's becoming a human form. Okay, so here the author says the announcement was made in the heavens and the earth regarding the fact that she, Amina, had now become pregnant and had now started carrying what? The personified light and nur of Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And when this happened, وَصَبَى كُلُّ صَبٍّ. Sab is an ardent lover. Saba means to incline towards, to turn towards. Hubub is the blowing of winds. And Saba is an easterly wind. وَصَبَى كُلُّ صَبٍّ لِهُبُوبِ صَبَى. And every ardent lover inclined towards the blowing of his easterly wind. that Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was found in the east there, and everyone who had a love for the Creator was now drawn to this wind, this news of this, or this wind of news that came from the east regarding the fact that the Nabi Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam had been conceived, that he had been conceived, that his mother now bore him. Okay? So, وَنُودِيَ فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. A call was made, a proclamation was made, an announcement was made in the heavens and the earth. بِحَمْلِهَا, regarding the fact that she was now pregnant, carrying, bearing what? The nur of Nabi Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, that was now becoming a person. Okay? A human being. وَصَبَى كُلُّ صَبِّنْ, and every lover of the Creator was now turning towards the blowing of that wind that was coming from the east. And again, this man was a poet as well, and it's not to be taken literally, but the idea that he is trying to get across here is that certain things were starting to change. Certain things were starting to change. Why? Because Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was not any human being to be born. He was the final messenger to be born. He was the most beloved of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be born. And he was the one who would be sent as a mercy, not to humans and jinn only, but to lil alameen, to the worlds, a mercy to the worlds, a mercy to all in creation. Allah is Rabbul Alameen, the Lord of the worlds. And Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is rahmah lil alamin, a mercy to the worlds. So we're coming to something at the end. Hang on. But he, the Sheikh, is trying to bring forth in words what he imagines was happening at the time when Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was conceived. وَكُسِيَتِ الْأَرْضُ, and the earth was draped, the earth was adorned, بَعْدَ طُولِ جَدْبِهَا, after its lengthened drought. Drought of what? Drought of divine message. Something was stirring now. The earth was now beautified. The earth was also waking up after, because between Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and Nabi Isa alayhi salam, there were more than 500 years, 600 and somewhat years. So for six centuries, there was no communication from the Creator to the creation. And now the medium for the final communication from the Creator, that medium was to be born. That medium was to be developed in the womb of his mother. That medium, none other than Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So the earth also was changing. فَعَلَطُوا لِجَدْبِهَا مِنَ النَّبَاتِ, after its lengthened drought from any produce. Drought from produce, النَّبَاتِ, it stopped from producing anything new. But what was it being draped with now? حُلُلًا سُنْدُسِيَّةً, with silk brocaded garments. Spiritual garments, like silk brocaded garments. وَأَيْنَعَتِ الثِّمَارُ, and the fruits ripened. وَأَدْنَ الشَّجَرُ, and the trees drew its bunches closer. لِلْجَانِي جَنَى, the جَنَاهُ, meaning its bunches. أَدْنَ الشَّجَرُ جَنَاهُ لِلْجَانِي, for the Arabic students, جَنَاهُ is the maf'ul. It's mudaf ilay, but it's the maf'ul for أَدْنَى. وَأَدْنَ الشَّجَرُ, and the trees drew what closer? جَنَاهُ, its bunches, its produce, right? لِلْجَانِي, to those who pluck them, to those plucking them, to those reapers. So he says the fruits ripened, and the trees drew its produce closer for those wishing to pluck them. Everything changed. The earth was draped, after a long drought from produce, it was now draped with beautiful brocade, meaning there was dew on the ground. There was dew on the ground, and there was fertility in the ground. And it was starting to shake and move preparing to bring new beneficial produce, and the fruits that were there struggling to pop, struggling to shine, those fruits ripened and the trees became accessible to people who wish to draw from its benefits. So let's read the Arabic. وَكُسِيَتِ الْأَرْضُ بَعْدَ طُولِ جَدْبِهَا وَكُسِيَتِ الْأَرْضُ بَعْدَ طُولِ جَدْبِهَا مِنَ النَّبَاتِ حُلَلًا سُنْدُسِيَّةً وَأَيْنَعَتِ الثِّمَارُ وَأَدْنَى الشَّجَرُ لِلْجَانِي جَنَاحٌ وَأَيْنَعَتِ الثِّمَارُ وَأَدْنَى الشَّجَرُ لِلْجَانِي جَنَاحٌ. Okay, again, the poetic, eloquent Sheikh Al-Barzanji is trying to set a scene for the state of the creation at the time when the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam was being conceived and soon to be born. Things were changing. وَنَطَقَتْ بِحَمْلِهِ كُلُّ دَابَّةٍ لِقُرَيْشٍ بِفِصَاحِ الْأَلْسُنِ الْعَرَبِيَّةِ وَخَرَّتِ الْأَسِرَّةُ وَالْأَصْنَامُ عَلَى الْوُجُوهِ وَالْأَفْوَاهِ وَنَطَقَتْ بِحَمْلِهِ كُلُّ دَابَّةٍ لِقُرَيْشِ. And every animal of the Quraysh spoke of his bearings, spoke about the fact that he was conceived, he was being carried in the womb of Amina. And the animal spoke بِفِصَاحِ الْأَلْسُنِ الْعَرَبِيَّةِ with the eloquence of Arab tongues. Now just bear with me, we come into something near the end, inshallah. Again, not to be literal, we could say it's metaphorical, however, we come into something at the end and just get the scene that he's trying to get across. وَنَطَقَتْ بِحَمْلِهِ كُلُّ دَابَّةٍ لِقُرَيْشٍ بِفِصَاحِ الْأَلْسُنِ الْعَرَبِيَّةِ وَخَرَّتِ الْأَسِرَّةُ. And the thrones وَالْأَصْنَامُ and idols خَرَّتْ fell عَلَى الْوُجُوهِ وَالْأَفْوَاهِ on their faces and mouths. The thrones of false deities, or the thrones of leaders and kings who claimed to be deities, or leaders and kings who were on false beliefs, their thrones shook and fell, and idols fell on their faces and their mouths. وَنَطَقَتْ بِحَمْلِهِ كُلُّ دَابَّةٍ لِقُرَيْشٍ بِفِصَاحِ الْأَلْسُنِ الْعَرَبِيَّةِ وَخَرَّتِ الْأَسِرَّةُ وَالْأَصْنَامُ عَلَى الْوُجُوهِ وَالْأَفْوَاهِ وَتَبَاشَرَتْ وُحُوشُ الْمَشَارِقِ وَالْمَغَارِبِ وَدَوَابُّهَا الْبَحْرِيَّةِ وَاحْتَسَتِ الْعَوَالِمُ. There has to be a fatha on the scene. وَاحْتَسَتِ الْ There you go. وَاحْتَسَى to sip from a drink. وَاحْتَسَتِ الْعَوَالِمُ مِنَ السُّرُورِ كَأْسَ حُمَيَّاهِ وَتَبَاشَرَتْ وُحُوشُ الْمَشَارِقِ وَالْمَغَارِبِ. Creatures of the east and west, وَدَوَابُهَا الْبَحْرِيَّةِ and its sea animals. نعم. Literally, it's supposed to be easts and wests, because there are various points in the east and various points in the west. So, creatures of the easts, no matter where in the east, in all its areas, as if it's individual points of east, the easts, and creatures of the wests, all the various points in the west, وَدَوَابُهَا الْبَحْرِيَّةِ, those are on land, but even its sea creatures, تَبَاشَرَتْ, gave each other glad tidings. Ya salam. Now again, just bear with me. This eloquent scholar is drawing a scene of things that happened. It wasn't that the earth just was the same when Nabi Muhammad was conceived and about to be born, or It wasn't that the earth was just the same as normal when the Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was born. Rather, everything in creation being directly communicating and glorifying the Creator, because everything in creation is glorifying Allah. And everything in creation is praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah says this in chapter 17 of the Quran, Surah Bani Israel, also known as Surah Al-Isra. وَإِن مِّن شَيْءٍ إِلَّا يُسَبِّحُ بِحَمْدِهِ وَلَكِنْ لَا تَفْقَهُونَ تَسْبِيحَهُمْ. There is not a thing in existence except it is glorifying with His praise, Allah's praise. But you, mankind, you are simply unable to understand its glorification. So it is connected. And as such, it worships Allah, and he who would be worshipping Allah the best, none other than Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And he who would be glorifying and praising Allah the best, none other than Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, leading all in creation. His presence would be a mercy for all. He was about to be born. So everything is connected. وَاحْتَسَتِ الْعَوَالِمُ. And all in existence, all the various levels of existence. Awalim is also a plural of the word alam. And you know the sound plural, al-alamin, rabbil alamin. A broken plural of alam is awalim, i.e. the various aspects of creation, the various types of creation, the various species of creation, all of them, al-awalim, all in existence, ihtasat, sipped. Min as-sururi, out of joy. What was it sipping from? Ka'sa humayyah, from the cup of his excitement, from the cup of his joy. Humayyah in certain contexts means wine. I didn't want to translate it here as a wine, even though it's a metaphor, even though it's not literal, but they became intoxicated with the knowledge of the fact that he is to come. So it was as if his soon-to-be presence was a wine that they were sipping from. Understand? But humayya also means excitement, euphoria, heightened level of joy. So out of joy, they sipped from the cup of the excitement that he was bringing, or the excitement of the news of his conception. The excitement of the news of his conception. All in existence. So we see the Arabic. وتباشرت وحوش المشارق والمغارب ودوابها البحرية واحتست العوالم من السرور كأس حمية وبشرت الجن بإضلال زمنه وانتهكت الكهانة ورهبت الرهبانية ولهج بخبره كل حبر خبير وفي حلا حسنه تا. وبشرت الجن. And the jinn were given the tiding of the approach بإضلال زمنه, of the approach of his time. The jinn were given the glad tiding, بِإِضْلَالِ زَمَنِهِ, of the approach of his time. إِضْلَال means actually to give a shade. Give a shade. The time that he comes will shade them, meaning will cover them as well. Ya salam. They will not be exposed to the sun of ignorance. Rather, they will also, the jinn will also be granted the shade of guidance. Isn't that beautiful? The jinn were given the glad tidings of the idhlal zamani, the approach of his time, of Nabi Muhammad s.a.w.'s time. But idhlal is a unique word. He could have used the other word, like the most common word in Arabic for an arrival or approach is qudum or wusul. You with me? Arrival or approach. But the author used idhlal. Idhlal means the fact that his time, Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam's time, will grant them shade as well. Will grant them shade as well. A shade of guidance, as opposed to being exposed to the sun, the openness, or the sun of ignorance. Because as a metaphor, the sun covers broadly, and you're looking for the shade here and there. keep safe. So likewise, ignorance was far and wide. Ignorance was spread all over, and you needed spots and pockets and shades of guidance. وَانْتُهِكَ تِلْكَ هَانَةُ The soothsayers were weakened. Those who proclaimed to see in the future, they were all weakened. وَرَهِبَةِ الرَّهْبَانِيَّةِ And the monks were in awe. The monks were struck with awe. وَلَهِجَ بِخَبَرِهِ كُلُّ حَبْرٍ خَبِيرٍ Habr is a rabbi. Khabir, well-informed, meaning learned. كُلُّ حَبْرٍ خَبِيرٍ And every learned rabbi, لَهِجَ بِخَبَرِهِ spoke of his news. Every learned rabbi spoke of his news. وَفِي حُلَى حُسْنِهِ تَاهَ Taha means to be lost, to wander around without knowing where you're going, right? Hula husni, and was lost in the refinement of his beauty. Now we're coming to this. The rabbis had some information in their scriptures regarding signs that they were looking for pertaining to the final messenger. And they saw some signs, and I'm going to mention two narrations at the end, inshallah, regarding what certain rabbis were heard saying before the Nabi Muhammad ﷺ even proclaimed to be a messenger. They had seen some signs. So there were some signs around the time of the perception of Nabi Muhammad ﷺ and the birth of Rasulullah ﷺ. So anyway, again, this eloquent sheikh is drawing a picture. And every learned rabbi spoke of his news, of the news of the approach of Nabi Muhammad ﷺ as the final messenger, and was lost in the refinement of his beauty, the refinement and the complete nature of the beauty of Rasulullah ﷺ. So, وَبُشِّرَتِ الْجِنُّ بِإِضْلَالِ زَمَنِهِ وَانْتُهِكَتِ الْكَهَانَةُ وَرَهِبَتِ الرَّهْبَانِيَّةِ وَلَهِجَ بِخَبَرِهِ كُلُّ حَبْرٍ خَبِيرٍ وَفِي حُلَى حُسْنِهِ تَاهِ Is the second part? وَلَهِجَ بِخَبَرِهِ كُلُّ حَبْرٍ خَبِيرٍ وَفِي حُلَى حُسْنِهِ تَاهِ Let's work on the traditional lagu, traditional melody. But coming there, here's the end of the third riwayat. The third riwayah, the third narrative in this collection of Imam al-Barzanji's Mawlid Qasida, the third set of information. So he says, وَأُتِيَتْ أُمُّهُ فِي الْمَنَامِ And his mother was approached in sleep. Okay, when she was asleep, she was approached. فَقِيلَ لَهَا So it was, and it was said to her, then it was said to her, إِنَّكِ Rather, let's see, let's change this to Then it was said to her, Innaki, verily you, indeed you, Qad hamalti, you have indeed conceived, you have indeed begun to carry. Bi Sayyid al-Alameen, the leader of the worlds, wa khayr al-bariya, and the best of creation. There is a narrative saying that she afterwards mentioned this, Amina mentioned this, Halima Sa'diya. We'll come to that. Maybe I'll mention, give you the narrative. And she saw a Noor exiting her when she gave birth or at the time of birth. But let's just complete this meaning here. His mother was approached in her sleep. Then it was said to her, Innaki qad hamalti bi Sayyid al-Alamina wa Khayl Bariya. You have indeed conceived the leader of the worlds, the chief of the world. Some translate Sayyid as master, the master of the worlds. But the Arabs were familiar with the word Sayyid, and they would use it in the meaning of the leader. وَخَيْلْ بَرِيَّةِ And the best of creation. فَسَمِّيهِ إِذَا وَضَعْتِهِ مُحَمَّدًا So, when you give birth to him, then name him Muhammad. فَسَمِّيهِ So name him إِذَا وَضَعْتِهِ when you have laid him down, meaning given birth to him, فسميه, so name him, إذا وضعته, when you give birth to him, what should she name him? Muhammadan. The name Muhammad is a unique name. It's the maf'ul on the second scale. It means someone who is constantly praised. Constantly praised. So even those who do not follow him, when they say his name, they are praising him because it means the praised one. Muhammad, the constantly praised one. So this narrative here says she was actually guided by a dream to name him Muhammad, and that name at the time was not a common name. Actually, it was never given to anyone. There's no record of anyone having that name before Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And you know what is the current fact? The current fact is that the name Muhammad is the name that's given the most in the world. Currently, the name that's given the most in the world is Muhammad. But he was the first to carry that name. Why was she advised to name him Muhammad? فَإِنَّهُ سَتُحْمَدُ عُقْبَاهُ فَوَلِي هِ His عُقْبَاهُ, his outcome, the outcome of his birth and the outcome of his experiences and the outcome of his life, سَتُحْمَدُ will soon be praised. فَإِنَّهُ سَتُحْمَدُ عُقْبَاهُ فَوَلِي his outcome will soon be praised. The outcome of his birth and all his activities and his life and his example will all be praised. وَأُتِيَتْ أُمُّهُ فِي الْمَنَامِ فَقِيلَ لَهَا إِنَّكِ قَدْ حَمَلْتِ بِسَيِّدِ الْعَالَمِينَ وَخَيْرِ الْبَرِيَّةِ Note the sukoon missing there. فَسَمِّيهِ إِذَا وَضَعْتِهِ مُحَمَّدًا فَإِنَّهُ سَتُحْمَدُ عُقْبَاهُ فَأُتِيَتْ أُمُّهُ فِي الْمَنَامِ فَقِيلَ لَهَا إِنَّكِ قَدْ حَمَلْتِ بِسَيِّدِ الْعَالَمِينَ وَخَيْرِ الْبَرِيَّةِ فَسَمِّيهِ إِذَا وَضَعْتِهِ مُحَمَّدًا فَإِنَّهُ سَتُحْمَدُ عُقْبَاهُ عَطِّلِ اللَّهُمَّ قَبْرَهُ الْكَرِيمُ بعرف شذي من صلاة وتسليم اللهم صل وسلم وبارك عليه عطر اللهم قبره الكريم بعرف شذي من صلاة وتسليم اللهم صل وسلم وبارك عليه. Inshallah, next week I'll have recordings of gentlemen. I'm waiting on them to send me recordings of the third one, this one. So we'll play it for you so you can hear it in the classic traditional Cape sounds, inshallah. But I said before we conclude with the session, there are things I want to mention to you. Hassan bin Thabit. Hassan bin Thabit, radiallahu anhu, was from the Ansar of Medina. And he was a poet. He was a poet. That famous poem that you hear, وَأَجْمَلُ مِنْكَ لَمْ تَرُقَطْتُ عَيْنِي وَأَحْسَنُ مِنْكَ لَمْ تَلِدِ النِّسَاءُ More beautiful than you, my eye has never seen. Better than you, women have not given birth to. خُلِقْتَ مُبَرَّأً مِنْ كُلِّ عَيْبٍ كَأَنَّكَ قَدْ خُلِقْتَ كَمَا تَشَاءُ You were created free from every defect. It is as if you were created as you wished. That famous couplet was formulated and uttered by Hassan bin Thabit. He is its poet. He was 60 years old, when Nabi Muhammad SAW entered Medina. How old was the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam when the Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam entered Medina? 53. The Nabi was 53 sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and Hassan was 60 years old. Okay, so how many years older was Hassan? 7. Hassan, this companion, was 7 years older than Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Hassan actually says, when I was a young child, around 7 years old. Listen to me. Don't look at the text quickly, Hajja. Haji. This companion says, when I was a young child, around 7 years old, I can clearly remember. What? I can clearly remember a rabbi in Yathrib. What is Yathrib? Yathrib is Al-Madinatul Munawwara. Yathrib is the name of Medina before the Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam settled in it. Yathrib became known as Medina. So Hassan grew up in Yathrib. And besides the Arabs in Yathrib, there were Jews there too. So Hassan, who's 7 years older than the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam, says, when I was around seven, meaning around the time when the Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was born, he says, I can remember a rabbi in Yathrib calling out one night, O Jewish brethren, Ya Ma'shara Quraysh, O community of Jews, Jewish brethren, Najmu Ahmad, the star of Ahmad has appeared tonight, marking his birth. The star, a star of Ahmad, the signs they were looking for, signs, they were deep, the rabbis. You see, a star appeared, and the star marked the birth of Nabi Muhammad. Some scholars have identified or thought, have tried to identify what star it is. And some claim to know which star it is that appeared, it became apparent, that shone from that night around the time when Nabi Muhammad was to be born. Al-Imam al-Bayhaqi documents this, and scholars like Al-Imam al-Albani, scholars like him, him included, have authenticated this narration, saying it's sahih. So think about this. Then, so things happened. Things happened around the time when Nabi Muhammad was to be born. Usama bin Zayd, radiallahu anhu, was a young Sahabi. He was informed that Zayd bin Amr bin Nufail, Zayd bin Amr bin Nufail, it's a long narrative, this was a unique man. This was a man who, before Islam, refused to worship idols. Refused to worship idols. And he, whenever he would find a rabbi, he would speak with him. He was an Arab, this Zayd bin Amr. He would speak with him and ask them about the scriptures. Because he couldn't get it in his heart to bow down to idols. And he passed away, unfortunately, 5 years before the Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam proclaimed and called to Islam. He passed away around the time when the Kaaba was being rebuilt and the Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam was 35 years old. But he informed the Qurayshis, and of them reported this later. Of them spoke with Usama bin Zayd, and Usama narrates that he was informed that Zayd bin Amr bin Nufail met a rabbi in Sham. What is Sham? Sham is the Levant. Sham is Greater Syria. Sham covered Palestine as well, and Jordan as well, and Lebanon, and as well as modern day Syria. He met a rabbi there who once told him, a prophet has appeared in your town, or he is soon to appear. His star has risen. Again, mention is made of a star. A star at the time of the advent of the birth of Rasulullah. So this rabbi told Zayd bin Amr, you are in the wrong place. You must return to where you came from. You must return to where you came from and believe in him and follow him. When that prophet proclaims his message. Return and believe in him and follow him. Because he was inquiring there about signs and asking about prophets, etc. So this rabbi told him, no. The signs are actually pointing. The signs are pointing to where you are from. And that man, that prophet's star has appeared. They looked at things differently. Anyway. Jabir bin Samura radiallahu anhu narrates that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, okay, We spoke about everything in existence changing and being affected. Al-Imam al-Barzanji said that the animals gave each other glad tidings. All in existence were drinking out of joy from the cup of excitement. They were all meaning they were drinking from the cup of excitement, meaning they were all feeling excited about the advent of the birth of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Everything in existence. Now see this hadith, authentic hadith documented by Imam Muslim amongst others. The Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam himself said, "Indeed, I know a rock, sakhra, like a hajar. I know a rock in Mecca that used to greet me even before I was sent with the message. Ya Allah. I know that rock even now." Jabir bin Samura was with Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in Medina. Okay? Jabir bin Samura was with Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in Medina. One second. Just to confirm, Jabir bin Samura, yes, Jabir bin Samura, Ibn Ukhti Sa'ad ibn Abi Waqqas, Khalifu Bani Zuhra, naam, Al-Thaqafi, okay, Jabir bin Samura, Sahabi, yes. He narrated Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said this. Naam. Want to confirm if it's an Ansari or Muhajir. Anyway, but Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to him, "I know a rock that used to greet me even before I was sent with the message." Meaning Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam saying here that he used to be in Mecca, walking around in Mecca, before he received wahi, before he got the first revelation, before he met Jibreel alayhi salam for the first time. And whenever he used to pass by this particular rock, he used to hear this rock greeting him. What are you going to say to that? The Nabi isn't saying it happened after I was receiving Quran, after I went for Isra al-Mi'raj, when he was in a spiritual high or heightened spiritual state. No, before I even got the wahi, before I even got the first revelation, he wasn't even instructed to call out to Allah yet. There's a rock that used to greet him, meaning he used to hear this rock say, "Peace be upon you," or greet him in some way. He doesn't say how, but just greet him in some way. Look at the next one. Ali reports, radiallahu anhum, "I was with the Prophet, peace be upon him, in Mecca when we went to one of its outskirts. There was no stone or tree that we passed by, except that it said, 'Assalamu alayka ya Rasulallah,' peace be upon you, O Messenger of Allah." Slow down. Take this in again. Ali radiallahu anhu is the young sahabi who never ever bowed down to any idol. Karramallahu wajha. May Allah grant additional honor to his face. Ali's face never bowed to any idol. Ali had another level of iman. Okay? Heightened from young, from 11, they say he was by the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's side as a companion calling to Islam. He grew up in the Nabi's house. He says, "I was with the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam one day. We went to some of the outskirts of Mecca. And what are they passing by? It's desert. So if they're not passing by a tree or two, they're passing by rocks, stones." He said there was no stone or tree that we passed by except that he could hear it himself. And Ibn al-Qayyim and others say he's speaking of an actual sound that he heard saying, "Assalamu alayka ya Rasulullah, peace be upon you, O Messenger of Allah." Al-Imam al-Tirmidhi documents this as well as other scholars, and the chain is strong. Chain is good. They were aware of the Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and here they acknowledged Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Consider verse 18 of chapter 27. Chapter 27 of the Quran is known as, it's named An-Naml, Surah An-Naml, which means the ant. In verse 18, consider this. In verse 18, Allah speaks about the incident when Nabi Sulaiman alayhi salam was walking with his various battalions that included humans and jinn and birds. Okay? And they were walking on a path that some ants were crossing. Allah says in this verse that the one ant said to the other ants, enter your homes, lest Sulaiman and his army steps on you, tramples you, without them realizing. In verse 19, Allah says, Nabi Sulaiman alayhi salam was able to hear this ant. And Nabi Sulaiman alayhi salam smiled and laughed and made dua to Allah, asking Allah to endow him with the ability to show true gratitude, etc. But the point is here, an ant in the time of Nabi Sulaiman alayhi salam recognized and knew of Nabi Sulaiman alayhi salam by name. Nabi Sulaiman alayhi salam was the prophet of his time. And an ant in his time knew him by name and recognized him. Do you think Allah will not grant that honor to the final messenger, Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Do you think that those in existence would not know the messenger of their creator as well? Allah is the creator of everything, and Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the final messenger of the creator of everything. So do you think everything would not have some connection to that final messenger, sallallahu alaihi wasallam? I'm not going to take up any more time. This discussion is for some other session, or some other period, or some other platform. But our Rasul, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, being the beloved of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, was loved by everything else too. Here we have a report by Anas radiallahu anhu, where he says some Ansar in Medina came to complain to Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam about their camel who was stubborn and refusing to be moved. It was stuck in a corner of their garden. So they went to Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So Anas says, I went with the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We entered the garden, and the moment we entered the garden, the camel turned and saw the Rasul. When it saw the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it approached him, and in front of him, it went down on its front legs as if bowing, acknowledging him. The Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam merely put out his hand, took it by the cord around his neck, and raised it and gave it to the Ansaris and said, "Yeah, deal with it." It subdued itself and humbled itself when it saw him in its presence. Okay? Al-Imam Ahmad narrates this. Abdullah bin Ja'far, radiallahu anhu, narrates something else. This is a profound one, but if you want, I can go into it some other time, inshallah. But Abdullah bin Ja'far says, I am riding on a horse with Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Okay? And we enter a garden of some of the Ansar in Medina. And when we enter, we see Ansaris struggling to pull a particular camel. And the camel sees Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and something happens. It starts making a funny sound, funny noise. And when I look at it, it's as if its eyes are tearing. Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam gets off the horse. Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam goes to the camel. The Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam rubs the camel on its back, rubs the camel on its ears, and he puts his face by the camel's face. Abdullah bin Ja'far says, I see this. The camel calms down. The camel was making a strange sound, like a wailing, crying, complaining sound, and its eyes were tearing. The Nabi rubs the camel's back. The Nabi rubs the camel's ears and puts his face by the camel's face. And then he turns around. After some time, he turns around and he addresses the Sahaba, the Ansaris, and asks them, whose camel is this? So the one Ansari responds, it's mine. So Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, it is complaining to me. It is complaining to me that you are not feeding it enough and you are burdening it with more than it can handle. Ya salam. Tuji'uhu, meaning you are leaving it hungry, but you are burdening it with more than it can handle. Now, what do you say regarding something like that? A human being like us, but with a divine connection, and everything else in creation is submissive to the Creator, acknowledging the message or the messenger that was sent by its Creator. So when Al-Imam Barzanji is saying that the animals gave each other glad tidings and the sea creatures too, etc., etc., he's speaking as a poet, but he's drawing from these types of narrations that he is fully aware of. I'll say it again. When Al-Imam al-Barzanji speaks so eloquently in this third riwayah about how the earth changed, things became more fertile, and the animals gave each other glad tidings and stuff, he's speaking metaphorically, with hyperbole, exaggerating, but he's drawing a scene, trying to get us to understand that things were not the same, things changed. Because they were connected to Allah, and Allah was going to send his final messenger. Not simply a messenger, but his most beloved. And not simply his most beloved, but one who would be regarded as a mercy to the worlds. And then, during his lifetime, Nabi Muhammad's lifetime, things like this happened. That drew Al-Imam al-Barzanji to be confident to make certain statements, because he drew the idea from these actual events in the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam's life, witnessed by the Sahaba and reported to us by them. So think about it. May we acknowledge our connection with Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam as he deserves. May we love him as he deserves. May we follow his example as we should. And may we come to realize the status and the rank and the position that the Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam holds by Allah, and that he holds in existence. He's Sayyidu Waladi Adam. He is the chief, the leader, the best of all the children of Adam alayhi salam. And the children of Adam alayhi salam were given some level of priority on this dunya because they were made vicegerents. They were made representatives, khulafa, individually khalifa on the earth. And Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the leader of all who were made vicegerents and leaders on earth. So, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, عطر اللهم قبره الكريم بعرف شذي من صلاة وتسليم اللهم صل وسلم وبارك عليه. May Allah continue to protect us for many good years ahead. May we meet again next week to conclude, inshallah, with the fourth riwayah, fourth set. And then, inshallah, I will play you some audio clips of people reciting these riwayat in the traditional way, and also how it's being recited abroad in other areas of the Muslim world, inshallah. Keep well. وصلي اللهم وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين، وسلام على المرسلين، والحمد لله رب العالمين، والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.